Yo, what's up, Cedarcrest? It's me, Justin.
I'm Logan.
I'm Erica.
And this is our YouTube channel. Enjoy. Yo, what's up? If we haven't met yet, my name is Justin. I'm the student pastor here at Cedarcrest. And I got a question for you. Have you ever not wanted things to change? I remember in high school, it was my junior year of high school. My family, we lived in Chicago, and my grandma, she lived up in Minneapolis, and so we drove to go visit her. We stayed at a hotel just outside the Mall of America, the largest mall in the world. It actually used to be one out where I lived in Schaumburg, but it's not anymore. Anyway, so in the middle of this mall, there is like an amusement park. Roller coasters and like water rides, and it's Camp Snoopy. I mean, it is phenomenal for someone who loves that kind of thing. I hate rides. Like, I'm the guy that would spend the 40, 50, 60 bucks to go to an amusement park and sit and watch everybody. You could pay for me and say, go sit on a ride. I'd be like, no, 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 no. Not gonna happen. So here we're sitting in Camp Snoopy, and my mom and dad, they begin to pressure me to change. Like, hey, why don't you go on a ride? I was like, not doing it. Not gonna do it. No. No. Eventually, I decide, you know, I cave. I'm going to give in to the change, and I say, I'm going to go on the swings. And that's the thing that goes around in circles, right? And the faster it gets, like, you begin to go from sitting like this to like this. Yeah, not cool. So I'm sitting there, and the dude who's getting paid minimum wage, he walks up, puts the thing on my waist, like, locks me in, and makes sure everyone else is checked in. He goes, and right before he hits the button, I start screaming, stop the ride! Let me out! I'm done! I can't do this! I rip the little harness thing off, and I run as fast as I can out of there. Yo, what's up? It's me, Justin, three in the threes, and today we're talking about sneakers. Specifically, three ways to clean your sneakers. So we got a couple of pairs here. There's grass in my bag, it's kind of unfortunate. All right, so three different types of sneakers here, and each one requires a different style, technique, system, you fill in the blank. First, if you are trying to clean a pair of Adidas sneakers, just throw them away because, well, that's where they belong. Now, if your sneakers are leather, what you're gonna do is you're gonna start out by getting a cloth wet, and you're gonna just kind of rub out any of the dirt. If that still doesn't quite clean them up and you want them sparkling white, I would suggest getting some white shoe polish and a soft towel. And I would just very delicately rub the polish on. Now, if you have a little bit of black and you put a little bit of white on it, it's gonna turn gray, so don't do that. Be super careful with how you're doing that. Wow. If, however, your shoes are more of a cloth-like substance, then you have a much easier situation. What you're gonna do is you're gonna take these, you're gonna grab some towels, and you're gonna go to the washing machine. And you're gonna turn the washing machine on cold water, delicate cycle. You're gonna toss them in the washing machine, and then you're gonna put a little bit of detergent, and you're good to go. Now, for a quick little touch-up on cloth shoes, all you need is one of those shout pans. Just rub it on, they're really good. That being said, before you do any of this, make sure you talk to mom and dad, because if you don't, I'm not buying you new shoes. I have an unhealthy obsession with sneakers, but I'm talking about sneakers that for me and my people, and I love you guys, but not enough to buy you a new pair of sneakers. So until next time, peace. See, oftentimes people either embrace change or they hate it. And if I'm honest, right now we're in the midst of a changing season. And if you haven't felt the effects of this change right now, well, it's only a matter of time before you do. And whenever we experience change, we tend to ask this one question: is everything going to be okay? I don't actually think that's the right question. I think we can ask a very different question. But when we ask, is everything gonna be okay? What we're really getting at is everything gonna go back to the way it once was? And the answer is always no. I mean, look at any world crisis. World War I, World War II, Desert Storm, 9/11, like every time something happens, we step into change and it never returns the way it was. More practical, have you ever broken a bone? When I was a year and a half, I thought I could fly. Not really, but I climbed out of my crib and I went for it and I fell and I landed on my arm apparently like this and I snapped both bones. That's a change. Once they removed the cast, my arm was better, but it wasn't the way it was before the break. You see, whenever you break a bone, it actually heals stronger. So the question isn't, is everything going to return to the way it once was? Because that's, no, never does. The question that maybe we should be asking is everything going to be the way it's going to be? And the answer is absolutely. It's absolutely going to be what it's going to be. Will it be different? I got to be honest, I don't know. My guess is probably. But it will be the way it's going to be. And so what do we do in the middle of all that? Like, what do we do in the middle of change? Well, if we look at what Isaiah 41:10 says, it's this: fear not, for I am with you. This is God speaking. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. I like that. Is it going to be hard? Yeah. Is it going to take time? Yeah. Are we going to get through this? Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And as we lean into what God is doing, I firmly believe that we are going to see change in an unexpected but amazing kind of way. Now, whether you like it or not, change happens. I mean, life as we know it has always been just a cycle of change. Something changes, we adapt, it becomes the normal, and then it just changes again. And there's two types of change that we experience. One is positive change, and the other is negative. Positive change, we love it, right? New outfit, love it, change. New friendships, new relationships. Maybe a brother or sister goes off to college and now you get their bigger room, change. Love that, The seasons change from winter to spring, and the cold goes away, and now it's warm. Love it. Change is good. No one ever questions that kind of change. But then there's the negative kind of change. You know, the change when a sibling leaves and now you don't have that best friend anymore. Or relationship ends. When it goes from fall to winter and it goes from warmer to colder. When mom and dad split. See, when that kind of change happens, everybody questions it. Maybe the change that you're experiencing this season is a whole new lifestyle, like you can't leave the house. Maybe the thing that you were once able to embrace, you can't anymore because mom or dad or both have either lost hours at work or have lost their job. Like, that kind of change leaves us saying, I don't want to deal with this. And then it begins to bring up a feeling we don't like talking about. But today, let's talk about it. See, when negative change happens, we begin to experience stress. Stress is a normal thing. Everyone experiences stress, but if we don't pay attention to it, stress can actually morph into anxiety. Stress is our response to the environment, but anxiety is our reaction to stress. I'll give you a definition of what anxiety can be. Anxiety is the fear in the absence of real danger. Another way of looking at anxiety is it's the overestimation of the probability of danger, or it's the exaggeration of the degree of terribleness. So what do we do when we experience anxiety? Well, oftentimes we run and hide. The other day, my son was sitting at the dinner table and we were enjoying, I think, dino tots and dino nuggets. He likes dinosaurs. And I began to smell this aroma. Wasn't a pleasant one. Yeah, Jackson had given this Mondo mega poop that like we could not stand. My wife's pregnant, and so the littlest irritable smell sends her running. And I'm like, hey, Jax, it's time to change your diaper. Said, no, daddy, no change diaper. I said, yeah, bud, it's time to change. No, daddy, no change diaper. I asked again, hey buddy, can I go and change your diaper? And he said, no daddy. And he ran away and he began to hide. He hid behind the curtains at our door, like the door of the backyard, and he's just hiding there. I can police him. His belly's like sticking out. I'm like, where's Jackson? And for a couple minutes I played around and I was like, oh, where'd you go? Where are you? And eventually I was like, hey, I see you, and it's time for me to change your diaper. You see, Jackson, he didn't want to change, and so he ran and hid. And my guess is you don't hide behind the shades or the curtains of a back door, but maybe you do hide behind like a smile or a new outfit, or maybe you hide behind an image or an attitude. Maybe you hide behind a joke or a comment. Maybe you hide behind the latest trends. Maybe you hide behind other people. Maybe you hide behind a substance like drugs, alcohol, vaping. Maybe you hide behind performance or grades. What do you hide behind? See, there's really good news when we step into seasons of change, and that's this. God uses change to bring people closer to Him. God uses change to illuminate His love, and God uses change to invite people into a relationship with Jesus. Now, there is a story that you may have heard when you were a kid. It's about a dude and a whale, and I'm not talking about Pinocchio, although what I am talking about is a whale of a tale. It's about a guy named Jonah. See, Jonah was a follower of God. He was actually used as a prophet or a messenger from God. And in this particular story, God sends a crazy message of change, and then a storm, and then a huge fish, and then a hot day, and then a plant, and then a worm, and He brings all of this together to bring about change. And in this case, it's not just change for a nation, it's change for a person. But in this story, God uses the change of a crazy message, a storm, a boat, a giant fish, a hot day, a plant, and a worm to teach Jonah and us something. And here's what I want to ask. Whether you've heard the story or not, whether you have made up your own conclusion about how this happened or did it really happen, whether or not you say, you know what, been there, done that, or what are you talking about? I want to ask you to just press pause on any of those thoughts and just give me a moment to try to connect the dots between the change of then to the change of now. See, the Bible's broken into two sections. You have the Old Testament and the New Testament. The Old Testament's all about life before Jesus. And towards the very back of the Old Testament, we find the book of Jonah. It's four chapters. It's like two pages. But in this, we see incredible change. God delivers this message to Jonah and says, hey, go to the land of Nineveh and tell them change or else. And what we need to know about Nineveh is that they were the enemy of God's people, the Israelites. Like, they were hated. The Ninevites, they prided themselves on being a people of, like, destruction and slaughter, and they loved to torture anyone who opposed them. So you can imagine being a messenger coming and saying, God said, change or else, like, what that might do. And so what does Jonah do? Well, he chooses to run and hide. And what's interesting is Jonah would have known the words in Psalm 139 where it says, where can I go from you? Where can I go from your presence? Can I go up? Can I go down? You are everywhere. But he doesn't follow it. Instead, he runs. And as he runs, he chooses not to embrace the change. He finds himself on this ship, and a storm breaks out, and these sailors, these professional seamen, they freak. They start tossing things overboard, and they start to like try to do it their way. My question is, in the middle of change, how do you take things on your own hands? Like, what do? How do you try to make things better? You know, Jonah, he ran. But years later, there's another guy named Paul who chose the opposite route. See, Paul, he grew up with all of the right stuff, the success, the education, the popularity, the power. And one day he's traveling to go and to punish followers of Jesus when he has an encounter with God. And it changes everything. His whole life changes. And he begins to look at all the things he once clung to after the change as insignificant. I mean, how crazy is that? So how do we do that? How do we, instead of running from God, how do we follow God into the unknown of change? Well, fortunately, we don't have to try to figure it out on our own. God has given us a roadmap, and the roadmap is the Bible. The Bible, it is a place that we can turn to for advice, for comfort, for encouragement. It's a place that we can turn to actually hear from God. Through the Bible, God actually speaks to us. He guides us, and he provides us with answers. Now, maybe you've never been taught how to read the Bible and then apply it to your life. For the past week or so, I've been Zooming with a handful of high school students, and we've been doing this thing called SOAP. It's not a super flashy thing. It's not complex. SOAP stands for Scripture, Observation, Application, and Prayer. And so here's how it works. You read something in the Bible, and you begin to jot down, what are you observing? That's step two. And then you look at your observations, and you say, in light of what I've noticed, how can I apply that, step three, to my life, and then pray that God would give you the boldness and the courage and the encouragement to carry out that application. How would your world look different in the midst of change if you embraced change by following God into it? Now, maybe you want help. We're going to keep doing this whole Zoom thing like every day. So if you want to jump in, let me know. DM me, hit me up, Justin Brecken on Instagram. I'll send you the link and we'll just kind of hang out and we'll go through this together, because in the end, change often divides, but what we can see is that God's bringing us together. And so let's embrace the change together, even in the midst of social distancing. Love you guys. And until the next time, peace. Hey, thanks for joining us today. And we want to give you a couple of potential next steps. So what I want you to do, pull your phone out, and I want you to do one of the following. If you are a middle school student and you want to stay up to date with what's going on with Cedarcrest students, I want you to text at CS-MS to 81010. If you're a high school student, I want you to text at CS-HS. So that's at CS-HS to 81010. If you have decided that, you know what, I am ready to take my next step and I've decided to follow Jesus, we want to celebrate with you. So what I want you to do is I want you to text at CS-saved to 81010, because we want to be able to reach out to you and give you some practical next steps as you continue on your journey. If you decide, you know what, my next step is actually to get baptized, what I want you to do is a text at CS-baptism, that's B-A-P-T-I-S-M, I can't spell, so I have to check it out. Again, it's at CS-baptism to 81010. And finally, if you're a brand new student and you're like, I don't know what's going on here, what I want you to do is just want you to text at CS, there's a theme here, at CS-IAMNEW to 81010. We can keep you up to date with what's going on, get you plugged into a group, and just say hi. So until next time, peace.